Can you come in for a second, please? Is your supervisor here? Can you go get him for me, please?
Hello. You do? You have? No kidding. Yes, of course. Oh, they'll be totally discreet. We got one!
Now, let's analyze what's been working for us. Not a thing's been working for us.
We got this.
We're the guard. And we protect our quarterback.
Radio pregnant?
Yeah.
How's that arm?
Good.
Yeah? What's that smell?
Wild yam.
That's nice.
This is Shoe KC Sports Pass, and now your hosts, David Brocks and Vernon Birmingham.
Welcome to Shoe KC Sports Pass. I am David Brocks, and I'm just thrilled to death. We have got the newest member of the Wu here with us.
Wu-Tang is for the children. Wu-Tang here to teach the kids.
Vernon Birmingham in the house. We will have our guest this week will be Rod Stahlbaumer. And Calum Harrison will join us a little bit later. We got our first look at the Bonner Braves yesterday, Vernon. Talk a little bit about what you saw from the high-powered, our first look at a high-powered offense.
About to say, what I saw was score early, score often, and that's what we saw. You know, a little bit on the ground, a little bit in the air. Defense played really solid as well. Was able to hold that Pacer offense that's been scoring. I mean, picking up some yards at least, not as much as scoring a lot of points, but been able to do some things on the ground, so was able to slow them down a little bit, and ended up inviting Molly Wap to the party.
So Connor Byers takes over at quarterback for Bonner Springs, as expected. Been in the program for a couple of years and backed up Jordan Jackson. Talk a little bit about what you saw from him, the junior, you know, getting the start nod. Now the lefty looked real confident back there in the Bonner backfield.
Yeah, kind of as I said on the back on the broadcast last night, the thing that impressed me the most was he made good, smart decisions. If it was in the option game when he had to make a couple pitches. In the passing game, you know, he put the ball in the spot where Jonah Freeze could be able to go up and get it. Then when they kind of did a better job of covering that over the top, he would check now to those dig routes going across the middle of the field. So he played really smart last night. I'm not going to say a game manager, but, you know, he put his team in position to make the right plays.
I think he probably had like four or five touchdowns passing and putting up numbers now that's going to have him in consideration for early season talk anyway for player of the year. And let's talk a little bit about this running back.
Only 3 games yet.
3 of 9. You got to start. They start doing Heisman talk in week one. We're doing Shoe KC player of the year.
Go ahead and put his name on the trophy, David.
You're going to have a trophy for him anyway. You were handing out the play of the year last year in game three.
Last night, I think we might have seen the play of the year, so.
Mr. Unruh with the long, many broken tackles was able to pull away. But let's talk about the running back from Bonner, Marcel Holmes. Real quick, patient runner, too. Was able to do a lot in the passing game and running the football.
Well, again, we can't talk about the running back without talking about the offensive line, and they did a good job of creating holes. He did a good job of having extraordinary vision from his, you know, a lot of his big runs were on cutbacks where he would go one way and cut back, where the defense of Baser was over-pursuing a little bit, so. And I think it also goes a little bit with how successful Connor was in the run game. So, you know, he's able to kind of do some read option work with him. And he took advantage of that and made some good runs.
You mentioned Jonah Freeze. He had well over 100 yards on just 3 catches, 2 touchdowns. So establishing himself, that Bonner offense looked very impressive. Talk about the defense and some of the players that might have stood out to you on that side of the ball.
Of course, you're going to ask me this one. I can't remember none of their names off the top of my head. But Daryl Terrell looked really good from the linebacker position. He did a good job of filling in. Again, Baser likes to run that flex, look for where they're going to try to run the ball in certain spots. And he did a good job of scraping from the linebacker position and making plays. Mr. Wiley, I believe, also had a really strong game up in the defensive interior from his spot. So, you know, those guys played really well.
Any positives you taking from Baser squad or anything you saw that maybe stand out that they can build on next week?
Positives is you get to play next week. They'll get a chance to maybe work on some other things, maybe try to expand their passing game a little bit. Again, it's offense. So we'll talk to Coach Stahlbaumer in a little while. But it's offense where you try to get in rhythm. You try to do a good job of picking spots and hopefully hitting that one big play. They weren't able to do that last night. Even on the big run they had, it was more of the individual effort by Unruh. But you'd be able to go back and look and see what didn't work. And with that offense, I've mentioned this numerous times now, Even with St. Thomas Aquinas is running this offense, and Mill Valley struggled in that game they played. But this is one of those offenses where, you know, typically it takes, you know, about 3 or 4 weeks into it, the defense or an opponent is able to finally see some film where they can start adjusting to some of those things. And we saw finally last night that happened with Bonner's defense stepping up and playing solid.
So let's go around all of our scores. Sumner Academy beats Harmon 40-0. You know, things don't look good for Harmon breaking that streak this year.
Yeah, it doesn't look good. But at the end of the day, I kind of said this week in a piece I put out there. At the end of the day, if these guys just stay out there and keep fighting, don't quit, but just continue to be out there fighting, it'll be successful from an individual manhood standpoint to be able to fight it through and not quit. So, you know, big ups to those guys for Harmon who's out there trying to fight it out. They're going to take lumps all year for the most part, but like I said, for them getting that win this year, it's probably not going to happen.
So rivalry week again as Sligo faces off against Wyandotte. A number of key players, seniors on the Wyandotte squad, did not play in that first half, and Sligo took full advantage, were able to beat down the Bulldogs in the first half, scored 32 points. I heard they played in the second half, and, you know, things kind of settled down and nobody scored in the second half. But talk a little bit about our Sligo Stallions getting that victory against the Bulldogs.
Hey, you just you go out there and play against whoever lined up out there, and they took advantage of it. It was able to finally put some points up through the first couple. I mean, they was able to kind of put some points up when they played East. Is that who they played early in the year? So, nationally, but to be able to put up some points against, I guess, a more even opponent was positive from the Sligo side of things. But Wyandotte, we'll see if they're able to bounce back once they you know, we knew early in the year with the teams they had to play, they would take some lumps, but now they're getting to league stretch a little bit. We'll see if they're able to have a bounce back.
So the talk of the KCAL right now has got to be the Atchison Redmen holding on to win against Washington. And to these KCAL teams, when it comes to these kickers, I mean, at no point was Washington even able to attempt an extra point. You know, the tie, they went for two the whole night, ended up scoring 26. Weren't able to get it in from a two-point conversion on a late touchdown that they scored. Turned the ball over 6 times. Talk a little bit about the Redmen and what they've been able to do early in the season. 3-0.
I mean, and being 2-0 in league is huge right now because they control their own destiny. You consider you chalk up Harmon as a win. So, you know, that's 3 league wins that they kind of have under their belt right now. So, you know, right now they kind of control their own destiny. So we'll see, you know, what they do this week. But at the end of the day, they're kind of been led by Joaquin, the Thrill Gill, you know, doing amazing things at the quarterback position and putting his team in situations where they're able to be successful.
So Atchison will face off against Harmon, and we'll talk about our picks a little bit later on. The Lansing Lions get their first victory of the season against Tonganoxie. Had to have it against these Tonganoxie team that's struggling so far this year. 37-12, a lot of good work on the ground by the Lansing Lions, you know, able to get that offense jump-started a little bit this week.
Yeah, you know, it took them a while even in this game to get going a little bit. But once they did, they was able to finally pick up some momentum and do some things there. So, you know, good job by Lansing finally getting in the column that matters.
Piper stays undefeated. Again, another workman-type effort. They're not putting up, like, gaudy numbers, but they are putting up gaudy numbers on defense. They had a report coming out of halftime that Lewisburg only had 2 yards. Talk a little bit about the Piper Pirates staying undefeated against Lewisburg, 24-0.
At the end of the day, when you get to the playoffs, things like that, that's what you want is solid defense being played. The offense was able to put up some points, however. I know they had a run that was called back, a long one. So, you know, we see the offense is starting to maybe reach that potential to be able to do some things. But the defense right now is going to continue to kind of guide the how far they're going to be able to go into the playoffs, especially when you start talking about playing teams like the Bishop Yates, who's probably the best, I mean, pound for pound, probably one of the best teams in the state. So that defense is going to be crucial.
Ty Baines with another touchdown pass, Trayvon Jones with another touchdown run. So, again, a lot of contributors on that offense for Piper, again, able to just, you know, pound and ground and pound. And we'll look forward to a matchup in a couple of weeks here as Piper faces off against Wart this week. But we got a Piper versus Bonner. We won't go too deep into that this week, but something to look forward to. And the Mill Valley Jaguars last night, minus Logan Cook, minus Evan Applegate, fall to Derby 35-14. Got a report, though, that and I saw a couple of highlights. Jagan was the best player on the field was the feedback that I got. So he was able to go down there and do some good things.
Yeah, and again, Derby is your Class 6A defending kind of runner-up in that sort of, I mean, In fact, if I want to say Coach Appleby's cousin coaches Derby, so it's kind of a little sibling kind of battle there. But even to go down there without potentially their best athlete not being on the field to still be able to kind of only lose, I mean, I say only by 21, it's solid. You know, they're going to be able to, we've been saying this forever, they're going to, you know, we knew looking at the schedule they had the potential to start off 0-3. They're going to get their first win this week. Then they have to come back and play a Staley team in Missouri that's pretty solid. So could easily be 1-4 kind of going into that stretch run, but it's going to, you know, these games that they're playing is going to put them in position to that stretch run to win ball games.
So huge week for the Turner Golden Bears. They go 3-0. They win on TV, Time Warner Cable, win against Bishop Ward, kind of a knockdown, drag out, slugfest, 13-6. I got to watch a little bit of the game at the beginning. Cole Henley had a big run return, but that Turner defense is playing real solid up front and, you know, bringing the wood.
Yeah, I mean, it kind of say, like you said, I saw a little bit that they had on the TV this weekend. I mean, they playing really solid on defense, which is what, again, is going to lead them as well. I mean, granted, Ward is basic vanilla from the offensive standpoint, but in other games, they're able to play solid D against your Washington team. So, you know, we'll see. I'm still not completely sold on you guys yet, Turner, but, you know, you're probably a couple of big wins away from me actually finally jumping all the way on. But you guys are doing what you need to do at this point in the time is win games and build confidence. That's the big thing. You know, win any, even if it's 13-6, 40-0, whatever, build some confidence for a program that's kind of rebuilding in a way.
So that team also, the KCTV5 Team of the Week, you know, shout out to everybody, Shoe KC, as well as the people at Turner that helped vote and make that happen. You know, again, as a community able to pull together and get those type of votes and get that type of recognition, Turner was like all over the place. I mean, everybody kind of heard from Turner this week. So very good for them and that program. Coach Milne's doing a great job. So right now we're going to get set. We're going to meet with Coach Rod Stahlbaumer from Baser Linwood, and we'll be right back with Shoe KC's Sports Pass with the Wu.
The Wu-Tang. So let's get to kind of Twitter to ask somebody ask you about your favorite story, whatever.
Actually, you know what? I think that was one of the canned questions they ask you at the beginning. Every day they have a question of the day.
And what did you say your favorite story was?
The kid that cried wolf.
And that is such a lame thing. I know what you're probably thinking. That's probably one of the lamest answers you could have put out there. Actually, do you know what the best story is?
What is it?
Slick Rick, children's story. That's the best story, and that's one you should have said. I'm disappointed in you, so we have to make sure to let the world know what that is. You can't say don't know.
I concur.
Justice stood, and people were behaving like they ought to good. There lived a little boy who was misled by another little boy, and this is what he said.
All right, David Brock's back, Shoe KC Sports Pass. We are joined by the new head coach at Baser Linwood, Rod Stahlbaumer. How are you doing, Coach?
I'm doing all right.
So we'll get to the game from last night in a second. You know, new coach in the area. Want to kind of get a little bit of a rundown on your background. You know, how'd you get started in coaching and, you know, where you've been for the past, you know, few seasons?
Well, I started out at a 1A school in Central Kansas, Quivira Heights. Spent 5 years there, two as the head coach, and then spent a year as an assistant at Rossville, and then took the head job at Linden High School in 2007 and spent the last 7 years there before coming to Baser.
So how'd you get your start in coaching? Let's kind of start off there a little bit.
Went to college, went into education. I've always had a passion for sports, and so I got in teaching and coaching assistant basketball, assistant football. Opportunity opened up to take over the head job at the school I was at, so I took that and kind of got a start that way.
So from a teaching perspective, what do you teach?
Social studies, okay. History.
All coaches are either social studies, history, or PE teachers.
So you came out your first year, 10-2 record, and then you kind of had a little bit of dip, so a little bit of a roller coaster ride in that coaching at Linden. Talk a little bit about that experience, you know, getting that success right off the jump and then maybe seeing it go down a little bit before you got back up.
Yeah, that first, you know, coming to Linden, you know, we had to kind of lay a foundation. And we had a lot of talented kids, and they'd had that a lot at Linden, where there'd been kind of that roller coaster like you're talking about, where they'd have some talent and, you know, they'd win 7-8 games but couldn't have any success in the playoffs, and then the talent would drop and they would drop off. And so we came in kind of with the mindset to create a program, to build a foundation. And that first year they had a talented senior group, and we were able to have some success. And they had not a lot below that. And the numbers were really low, had a lot of young kids. I think we started six sophomores and two freshmen the next year, and had one of our best athletes transfer to Lawrence Free State with just a parent issue, and ended up being a two-way starter for them. So we lost some talent off that team, and but we built them, kind of laid the groundwork to where, you know, if you look every year after that, we continually got better, to where, you know, they're 3-0 again this year and doing well. So just try to build it up.
All right, so from a coach's perspective, coming from a smaller school, now moving up into a school where you play 4A, 5A schools, talk about a little bit, you know, is there much of a difference? I mean, sure there is from a size perspective, but from an X's and O's perspective, is there much difference for you from a, you know,
head coach? No, there's definitely a difference. You know, when you get into the 2A level, your numbers are a lot smaller as far as the number of kids out and the number of kids there. So, you know, there's a lot more weaknesses on the field because there's going to be situations where teams have to play kids who just aren't as experienced as older kids. And when you get to this level, you're going to see a lot more senior-heavy teams and junior-heavy teams and guys who are physically more mature and more experienced. So it makes it a little bit more difficult offensively, defensively, because there's more weapons and more threats to prepare for.
What about from the QB? It's kind of a different question because Baser's always had kind of that strong community backing within the sports programs. But in those smaller schools, you see, I mean, a lot of those smaller schools, pretty much the town, the community all rallies around those athletic programs. So
that was one of the things that kind of drew me to Baser, was their community support. And you know, even though it's in an urban area, it definitely had a small town feel, where that is kind of the only show in town for Baser community. And so they come out and support their events, and they're passionate about their programs. And that had a very small town feel to it, because like you said, in a small town, that is kind of their thing. That's all they've got. So, you know, I thought that was very similar between the two.
Shout out to Casey's in Baser too. You know, they'd be having that pizza before we go on broadcast, and I'm starving, so I'm talking about food a little bit, but hey.
So talk about that opening win. You really got everybody excited. Big run by Justin Phillips in overtime to get a win against a good team in Baldwin. Talk a little bit about the reaction, getting that first win out of the way as a new coach at a new school.
Oh, you know, it was big. You know, anytime you come in as a first year to a program, you know, their kids were very receptive to the message, but they got to see that payoff too. And so for us to come in and get a victory game one was, I think, pretty big in getting our kids to buy in and continue to work. So it was a big win. You know, our kids played very, very well and fought through adversity. We actually fell behind 3 times in that game and came back and responded each time and made the plays at the end when we needed to.
So what are some of the things that you did, I guess, in the summer to kind of get the new, you know, the new squad, to kind of get them affiliated with the type of philosophy that you have from a coaching perspective?
You know, I actually started in the spring a little bit where even when I was still at Linden, I sent out weekly emails that kind of went play by play and showed some video clips and talked about the kind of offense that we'd be running. The defense was relatively the same. Coach Lohafer, our defensive coordinator, was back, and so we've kept a lot of things similar defensively just to try to help some continuity there. You know, we started right away in weights. I got the chance to help with that. You know, Coach Sweezer does an excellent job with our weights program, and I got to be a part of that this summer, which helped, you know, get to know the kids. And, you know, I kind of ran certain parts of it in the summer with the football guys just to kind of build some mentality stuff, some team-building stuff. We went to a team camp in Atchison at Benedictine College and spent 3 days there and kind of got the kids around each other and together. So I think that helped us, you know, get off to that good start, is that they did have, you know, a whole summer together doing some of those things.
You followed that Baldwin game up with a shutout at Lansing. So talk a little bit about the defense so far and how they, you know, have responded to what you guys are trying to get done up there.
Defense played really, really, really well the first two games. You know, in our kind of our strategy, I guess, the first couple of games was our offense was, you know, we're still feeling our way out and through the nuances of some of the offense, but we were able to move the ball well enough to keep our defense on the sidelines for a long time. And, you know, offense is all about flow. And as you saw last night, Bonner got into a pretty good flow and it made it tough to stop. And, you know, the first 2 weeks, you know, we didn't move the ball real well offensively, but we moved it well enough to string together first downs. We had 29 first downs the first two games, and that did disrupt the flow of the opponent's offense a little bit and help our defense out, and they played really well to, you know, keep our offense in good positions. So that was kind of the, I guess, what we tried to do the first couple of weeks, and it didn't work real well last night.
So let's talk a little bit about last night. You guys took one on the chin a little bit. Did you see what you expected to see from Bonner? Were you surprised that their passing game opened up a little bit last night, or kind of what you expected when you kind of prepared for them?
Yeah, well, you know, they ran what we'd seen on film. You know, we knew they were good. We knew that the competition they'd played was good. You know, being kind of down in that area a little bit, I was familiar with how good of a program Chanute had, and so we knew that was a good win for them. Their passing game did surprise us. Now, you know, the Chanute game, it was a really, really windy night, and so they just didn't connect on some passes that maybe made their passing game look like not as much of a threat as what we saw last night. But it's tough to prepare for the speed that they had without seeing it in person, and I think that they might have been a little faster than what we thought about coming into that game.
And we talked a little bit before we got started here, you know, how do you approach that with preparing for a team like Bonner when, you know, you run your offense that you do, kind of a flex running style offense? How do you replicate that in practice to try and get them prepared for a game like that?
Yeah, it's always difficult, you know, trying to replicate somebody else's offense in a four-day time period and try to run as well as they're going to run it. But, you know, we have some depth with our skill guys. They're just young. And so, you know, trying to get a good scout look is difficult. But we do have some kids with some speed, but they're not going to be as explosive as what Bonner had. So, you know, we're trying to simulate the best we can.
So the offense that you guys kind of run is actually one that I'm familiar with because we ran it at the college. I used to coach that. So when you kind of, you know, run the ball a lot and you get behind a little bit, I guess how tough is it for you to kind of get out of that to kind of open up a passing game to play catch up?
It's difficult. And like I said, this offense is really about rhythm. It's staying, you know, on track, staying, you know, in that second and seven, third and three, you know, trying to keep in good down and distance situations where you can have the threat of run pass inside outside. And we got down and got into some, you know, situations where we needed to throw the ball, and Bonner reacted. They played with a lot of three safety looks and back guys off when they got the lead, that made it difficult for us to pass as well. But you know, that it, we kind of lost on third down a lot. We didn't convert, especially early on a lot of third and shorts that we had been in the last 2 weeks. And it seemed like every time Bonner was on third and 15, third and 17, they found a way to convert and keep the ball moving, the drive moving for them too. So, we didn't get on track offensively very well.
So we talk a little bit about the rival. There's a big rivalry, Bonner Baldwin. They played their starters a little bit late and even had that deep pass at the end of the game. You know, talk a little bit. I guess the story I would tell is back. I started following in 2011, Bonner Springs, and Aslan's first year, he took it on the chin a little bit from Hopkins, giving up 69. Do you think they're? What's your philosophy on that as a coach? I mean, do you pull the dogs out, or do you just keep it going?
Oh, you know, in those situations, it's tough for me to say what, you know, is best for their team. For us, you know, we're going to try to get as many guys in the game and opportunities as we can. However, you know, I've been on the other side. I've been on both sides of that coin. So for us, from our perspective last night, I guess that's, you know, if their starters are in, then we're going to get a better practice against their guys in a live competition than what we would get, you know, against their JV. So our guys have to continue to play and continue to make plays, and we got to get better. So, you know, I can't really speak to what would be best for their situation.
Yeah, David asked the question a lot nicer than I would have. I would have been like, are you the type of coach that says it's our job to stop them, yeah, or are you the coach that says, what the hell are you doing? Can I say that on TV? Yeah, I can say that on TV now. So, yeah, I mean, I kind of threw that out there. But at the end of the day, like you said, you got to stop them if they're still out there or continue to kind of get better, as you kind of said a little bit. So, let me see where we at. I'm trying to follow along here. You may not play a team on offense like you did with the Bonner game, with the Lansing game. Actually, I'm playing catch up here, so let me see.
Vernon Birmingham. Let's stop the tape right now. No, I'm just kidding. No, I guess where I was going
I went off track a little bit. I kind of freestyled a little bit.
So, I mean, you won't face a team like Bonner, right? I guess, coming up. You know, Turners of the world, Piper, you know, they run the ball. Do you kind of throw away that, or do you kind of just, you know, bank, you know, playing against a passing team like that and kind of get back to focusing on, you know, playing teams that run the ball a little bit more often?
Oh, you know, you got to adjust to your opponent each week. And, you know, we'll play some teams here down the road, I'm sure, that can throw the ball. And we're going to need to be able to stop that too. But, we're going to start focusing on what Turner does and try to find the best way to stop it and, you know, try to improve to 3-1 next week.
All right, so through three games, you guys are averaging 226 yards and 15 points per game. Like you kind of mentioned earlier, timing is such a huge part of your offense. So what are some of the things, I guess, within the handoffs and snaps you guys look to work on heading into this week?
Oh, you know, we feel like we're really close. It doesn't look like it at times, but we've moved the ball at times when we've gotten in rhythm and we've made some dumb penalties to get us into those, you know, negative yardage situations. You know, I thought our backs did a better job, especially later in the game, getting into the B gap. That was something we struggled with, is just knowing where the holes open up in this offense and taking the correct path. And I felt like we improved upon that a little bit, but we got into that situation where we had to throw and didn't get to work on as much as we thought. But we had some snap issues a little bit. We rotated a couple of centers in last night, trying to find somebody that can, you know, both get the snap and get to the second level and get linebackers blocked. We got to continue to improve. So you know, we're going to continue to rep. We may try to simplify a little bit of what we do and try to get better at a smaller amount of stuff rather than try to run so much stuff. But we kind of got in a situation last night where we had to open the playbook up and, you know, try to find something that would work.
The first time you said you ran the offense before, and it just looked like a flex bone, but kind of what I thought was interesting is you go from the pistol, you just find that gets them back into a position, you know, maneuver around. What's the kind of thought process with having them in the pistol?
Yeah, we moved to that. We were under center the first 4 or 5 years I ran this offense, and, you know, just statistically breaking stuff down, we kind of got into – anytime we got into a passing situation, we didn't have to go into the gun, and it made us real tendency prone. And so we moved to this shotgun version about 3 years ago, and I felt like it – took away a lot of our tendencies because now we were running the same run game from under center, but always had the threat to pass. Also, with the personnel we've got this year, Phillips is a shorter quarterback, so getting him away from center I think helps him a little bit there. It makes the quarterback a little bit more of a run threat because now we can run him out the backside and the front side. We're in traditional option. He's just coming out the front side. And the two of the backs we don't have that big bruiser fullback that a lot of times you'll see in this offense where you got that 215-pound kid who's just going to bang it inside. And this gives our guys a little bit of chance to use vision. We haven't done that real well yet, but that was kind of our thought process coming in.
So you mentioned Justin Phillips, your sophomore quarterback, who you end up naming as a starter, obviously. So how important is it for you, I guess, having somebody who's going to be able to, you know, potentially lead this offense for 3 years to kind of lay that foundation you're looking to do?
Oh, I think that's huge, you know. And Justin's done a great job so far as a sophomore. It's a learning process for him, and he's going to make mistakes. And, you know, he's going to play – he plays a little more cautious right now, which is kind of what we've asked for him as far as taking some shots deep and stuff. He's trying to be a game manager and keep us in games. And the first couple of weeks that worked really well because our defense was playing well enough, and that's what we needed from him. So I think as he continues to grow with this position, he's exactly the kind of quarterback that this offense is kind of built around. So I can see him growing and becoming a very, very good quarterback.
So, Jerron McPherson, you moved him over to safety. We noticed he was leading the team in tackles, which could be a bad thing from a defensive back standpoint, but he's rushing to the line and playing real good for you guys in run support.
Yeah, you know, that was a deal where, you know, Jerron was a great corner for us last year. We felt like teams couldn't run away from him as easily if he was playing at the free safety spot and be able to run the alley both sides of the ball and be more of a downhill, you know, defender. That was kind of one of the reasons we put him there because Jerron does an excellent job of studying film. I mean, we're in there Monday in our walkthrough, and he knows what plays they're running out of each formation. And so as a result, he has good instincts, and he gets the line of scrimmage. And, he's leading our team in tackles, and I'd say about 90% of those are done at or near the line of scrimmage. So that's kind of enabled him to run the alley both directions and be more of a defensive player for us.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, considering where he makes the tackles, it's maybe not as bad of a thing because, like you say, he does. I mean, he takes good angles. Last night he struggled a little bit in some angles that I kind of saw, but he takes good angles and make plays at the line. So
Yeah, I think Bonner did a good job of stretching their formations out. They ran a lot of their sets a lot wider than what we'd seen on film, and I think a lot of that was to try to take Jerome, make him have to run farther and take different angles than what he had in the first couple of weeks.
You had another sophomore cornerback, Eric Scott, that led you in tackles. He had 9 last night, struggled a little bit in the one-on-one, but was still, you know, good against the run in terms of coming up. Talk a little bit about him being a starter on your varsity team.
Oh, you know, Eric's done a great job. He's young. He actually could be a freshman. He's one of the youngest kids in his class, and he's a great athlete. And as he gets more and more experience playing football, he's going to be a phenomenal football player as well. He's done some really nice stuff for us. The inexperience showed a little bit on some of the deep routes and things. But as the more he plays and the better his instincts get, I think he's going to be a very, very good, you know, he'll be a lockdown corner for us before it's all said and done.
Yeah, he has good size, too, which I like seeing him last night. All right, you have a 3-0 Turner team coming in who's playing with a lot of confidence. So, kind of like you said earlier, back to the grind as far as getting prepared for that. And, you know, both teams, you know, other than last night a little bit, but both teams been playing strong defensively. What do you kind of look for in the battle against Turner?
You know, interestingly, Turner runs a very similar offense to what we do. So, you know, we'll go from, like you said, having an offense that's tough to simulate in practice to having one that hopefully we can simulate a lot better. You know, they run some things a little differently than we do, and we run some things they don't. But, you know, it's going to be a good matchup. It's homecoming for us, and you know, we obviously need to get some confidence back because we didn't play very well on Friday. But, you know, I know they're playing really well, and our kids, I think, will be ready.
So what did you tell your guys? You have film maybe this morning or walk through, I mean, kind of stretch out, but what did you tell your guys this morning or last night after the game?
You know, we talked about the fact that, you know, we've got to handle adversity. You know, football's a lot of fun when we're winning, we're 2-0, and guys are excited, and now the real test to how good we're going to be is how do we handle adversity? How can we bounce back from this? Because if we let one game beat us twice, then, you know, it's going to be a long season. So, you know, we're going to learn from our mistakes, and I think we got some guys who were pretty disappointed with the way things turned out last night, and hopefully that'll motivate them to continue to work and get back after it this week.
Well, Coach, we want to welcome you to the area. You know, good job so far. You know, keep pushing, and we wish you the best of luck the rest of the season.
All right, thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
All right, this is David Brocks. We'll be right back with Caleb Harrison. Back, Shoot KC Sports Pass. We are joined by the quarterback from the Washington Wildcats, Caleb Harrison. How you doing?
I'm doing good.
So, Caleb joins us. 1-2 start, probably, I mean, definitely not what you guys expected coming out, but talk a little bit about, you know, this start you guys have gotten off to.
Man, the start is just basically communication. You just need everybody to get on one page. I mean, I felt like over the summer we're doing good. We working out, doing hard. But it's just time for us to put it all together. Time for us to believe in the coaches and in ourselves, you know, just getting in the family trust and just doing our thing, man.
So talking about a little bit working on the same page, you guys turned the ball over 5-6 times last night, some of them on the snap, some of them on handoffs. Amazingly, you guys had an opportunity for a two-point conversion to win. So, you know, talk a little bit about trying to overcome all the mistakes that you guys had last night.
Well, I take ownership for the mistakes because, you know, last night I had to play with a brace, and it was really uncomfortable a little bit. So most of the fumbles and, you know, handoffs is on me. But the adversity thing, we good with that. We know our identity. We can fight with it. That's just like we did. We was down, went, I think it was like an 80-yard drive to score, and then we had it. We just, I don't know. I can't tell you how we did it, why we didn't do it. We just had to push a little bit harder to get the win.
So there was a couple of calls. I watched the game this morning on Huddle. There were a couple of calls in the game. The first touchdown that they had off the fumble, guy looked like he got up off the ground and recovered it and ran it in. Did they, any explanation on you know, whether why they didn't call him down or what happened on that play?
Man, I don't know. I thought he was down. Coaches thought he was down. It's just up to the refs. The refs said the ball was out before it goes, so then they scored. We just had to bounce back for it and score again for us.
So you picked off the ball in the end zone, you know, playing a little. You talked about the quarterback, you know, pretty solid D-back, I must say myself. But you picked off a ball in the end zone. You looked like you wanted to bring that out. You know, what was kind of going through your head?
Cut. Oh, man.
Thought you was going to go hun?
I seen open grass.
He was about to, but this is another one of those plays I was talking about. You kind of look back and shot. The guy grabbed him, and he kind of spun around a little bit and shook loose and started running out of the end zone, and the rep blows the play dead.
Yeah. They said it was a touchback or something, like just like a safety. Once we pick it off in the end zone, we can't run it out. But I remember last year I had a pick with Lance and his
and you Slater came out against
came out the end zone. So I'm like, I don't understand. I just seen open grass, and I was ready to go.
Singleton had another play where he ran back 104. It was just a weird call. But, again, you've been playing on both sides of the ball. Is that, I mean, do you get worn down throughout the course of a game playing both sides of the field? I mean, you're on the field pretty much every play, every snap on offense and defense.
Well, I wouldn't say worn down. You know, everybody do get tired, you know, catch your breath. But
everybody does get tired. I don't get tired.
I do a lot of conditioning, as I can tell. Coach King with basketball kicks our butt, and Coach Salzgiver always running, lifting. So, you know, I condition a lot. And then I also have, you know, a little trainer that I go to and just conditioning us, making us stronger. So tiredness is not really in my vocabulary.
I hear that.
So thoughts on this new look Atchison team that you saw a little bit last night? You know, what's your thoughts on them? Seeing them,
they was really good. I wouldn't say they were gonna kill you through the air, cause you know a lot of their passes, you know, inconsistent as I can say. But they backs Joaquin and then the other running backs running hard. They got a lot of good lead blockers. They physical enough, as I can say. But I still, in my mind, we still should have had that win.
So you guys got a rivalry game coming up against Wyandotte on Thursday. Coming on TV, talk a little bit about how you guys can bounce back now and a little bit of extra exposure being on TV against your rival.
Wyandotte, you know, last year, I ain't going to name no names, but somebody had Wyandotte to go all the way and be league.
You don't even have to say any names. We'll point at him. This guy right here.
And I didn't want it to happen. Deep down in my heart, every year we play Wyandotte, I just want to win. That's just and then this can be a good build-up game. Now that we lost to Atchison, we have to win all of them. And this can be our confidence builder. Once we beat Wyandotte, then we go on to play Harmon with homecoming. And then I feel like that once we get that win, we just build it up and keep moving.
So what's funny about that, though, David kept putting off that walk, thinking people would forget about it. And actually, heard you were one of the ones going to Coach Salzgiver. It's like, hey, what's up with this walk he's supposed to do? Try to get out of it, man.
I officially made the walk. Things kept happening. You know, honestly, every single time I tried to do that, I had a death in the family, like the first two times. My grandmother died the first time. I can't remember who passed away the second. But I did officially make the walk from Wyandotte to Sligo. I could have walked to Washington, man. That was a nothing walk it turned out to be.
Oh, yeah.
AD over at Sumner Academy, Coach Chris Will.
But you were the one, Sam. Somebody please meet me at Schlegel with a car.
Oh, no, you got to be smart about it. It's going to be a one-way trip, man. And we're going to turn around and go back home.
I'm a competitor, though, anyway, man. I don't like being the underdog. Even though it's cool, I like to be on top. And that's just that's my personality.
So you talk a little bit about your process. You started as a quarterback as a sophomore. Talk about your journey now in your senior year and, you know, going through that whole process and how you've matured as a player.
I mean, it's solid flash. Basically, with quarterback, it wasn't really the skill set per se. You know, you do work of footwork, you know, a lot of knowledge on the plays. But the biggest thing for me is the leadership. Because when I was a sophomore, you know, I was young. And I had to be a leader to seniors and juniors that was here before me. Even though now it's a lot more on me. My sophomore year, you know, we had Lloyd and Isaiah, and they was taking the leadership role. Last year we had Marvin Bowens taking on that leadership role. Now it's us. It's me and Jay, Steven, you know, developing as players since we was a kid. I mean, like, it's crazy. This is what we play for. It's like to be a better man, to be a player, better football player, and to take your team a long ways, man. I don't think we've been a state since the school opened, to be for real.
Playoffs, I'm not sure it's been a
playoffs.
Playoffs. Playoffs.
So you say you're a competitor, and, you know, again, big game coming up this week.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, kind of rumor goes around Wyandotte didn't have, you know, their full unit playing Thursday night. So are you one of those guys who you want to go against their best? You want everybody out there, or you'll take that competitive advantage if they don't play? We'll go give it to them.
I mean, anybody that's on the field, I feel like they can get it. Man, a win is a win. I'm not trying to lose. If they had a full people out there, so be it. We still have to go out there and do our thing and get this W. And if they don't, then they don't. We still trying to get this win. We're not going to slack up because they losing people. No, we still trying to put it on Wyandotte.
So you guys are in your 3 years. When you were a sophomore, you were coming in that first year with Sauce Giver. Mm-hmm. I mean, Washington was getting beat down pretty good at that point. Yeah. Talk about, you know, the transition and you being a part of, you know, building this program back up to where you guys are relevant.
It's not just me. It's the team. I give so much props to Coach Sauce Giver. My freshman year, we had a coach, and, you know, our football team was so discombobulated. Just so confused.
That's a pretty big word you pulled out the dictionary there.
We
got to go check his ACT scores or something.
Yeah, we were so confused.
Say that word again.
Discombobulated.
Oh, man, I'm going to put that in my arsenal.
There you go.
Nah, we were just so, I don't know. We wasn't really a family. Coach Charles Gibb came in here bringing a total new vibe. Just, you know, loyalty and effort was his motto my sophomore year. Then just coming out there suiting up with us during practice, trying to give us a good look on scout. He's just bringing that energy. And once that energy bounces off of certain players in the on the team, we just let it go. We just start rolling. And it's just so amazing what he just did with this program.
So it's been a little bit of an interesting week at Washington, so the media says, with the fights and things that you kind of see on the news and going out there. So has that been a distraction at all, you know, from a football perspective for the team?
Nah, for the team, we know we're there. We're trying to make it bigger. We're trying to get out to college, man. We here to school, not to fight, not to interact. Yes, we social. We can talk to people, but we're here to get our education. Then we're trying to score high on the ACT, SAT, whatever they want to take, and then we dare to play football. After this, after school, we go straight out to practice, you know, get warmed up, get loose, and we out to work. All this other stuff, all the fighting, all that stuff, they don't have nothing to do with the Washington football team.
So I'm going to put you on the spot there. So kind of known as the quarterback, the basketball player, everybody in the school knows you. Do you feel like any responsibility at all to try to, not being the one to break up stuff, but kind of, you know, be that
voice of reason.
Yeah, that voice of reason around school.
Nah, man. I lead by example. People do what people do. If y'all see me walking good, talking good, and if people really do look up to the way they do, they will follow. It'll bounce off.
So that's what I'm gonna challenge you to do right here on Shoe KC. I want you to get on a table in the cafeteria. I don't want you to say what Jameis Winston said. I want you to get on top of the table. I want you to say, we need to get it together, watch it. Come on, you can do it. I'll come up there with you, man. I'll come up there and, like, blow a trumpet so everybody get your attention.
Yeah, we got a change in our administration, too, so that, you know, we're trying to work out all the bugs and all the kinks with that. It'll get better.
So you guys had a couple of key pieces out. VO, your center, was out. Peoples didn't play in this past game as well. Mm-hmm. And Williams was even nicked up, midway through the Turner game and didn't play the next week as well. Talk a little bit about, you know, do you guys still feel any – you still feel very optimistic about the next following weeks if you get them all back?
Oh, yeah. We always still optimistic. I'm going to say next week will probably be the first week we have our legit full team. You know, Turner, Javion got out with a, you know, slight mild concussion or whatever. AC Prep, we had a couple guys missing. And then, you know, Atchison, I was hurt. People was off, couldn't play. Next week is our full team, so I can say. And then I just feel confident in everybody that we can really pull out this. And my goal is districts. League is fine. We lead champs last year. Of course, we want to repeat, but my thing is districts. I want us to get better each week so we can get to the playoffs.
So we got a chance to kind of see you in hooping last year. So, you know, also know that you're a guy, I think you got a little game on the hardwood. Yeah. So, what do you think your college option is? Is it going to be football, basketball? What do you think is best suited for you?
Man, it's just a coin flip. I basically want to do what's best for my education, for real, whether it's football or basketball. I love the game of basketball. You know, I like it, but football brings out my competitive nature. So either one would be fine. It just all depends where God want to take me and just follow my heart.
So I'm going to ask you this. You know, how much does the football play into how you are on the basketball court? I kind of remember doing the Harmon game or some game we did last year, and I kind of talked about a couple of you football players.
Yeah.
We're out there kind of, you know, giving some shoulder bumps, pushing them around a little bit. So, how much does that football cross over for you guys in basketball?
We physical. We smash mouth. That's all we got. Football is physical. Basketball is physical. We all got to get that competitive nature to bring the dog out of us, basically. We always got to scrap. That's we're both combined at a we're just scrappers.
So you got two contrasting coaches with Coach Salzgiver and Coach King. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have a little fun with Mr. Harrison here. I need you to give me your best Coach King impersonation right now in the huddle. So you guys have been messing up. He pulls you out. He calls a timeout and pulls you guys to the side. What's Coach King saying on the sideline?
He'd be like, come on, fellas. We got to get this ball. We got to go score, fellas. Come on.
He actually did the face impersonation and everything. Oh, fun. Man.
He's so animated. Coach King, I love that guy, man. He's so animated. He always gets us pumping.
What about Coach Salzgiver?
Does he have a go-to line?
He's so mellow. He just, I don't know. He always talks to me with his hand over his mouth so the other team won't see him, so I really can't tell his face expression. He's just so mellow. He's so calm, man. I don't know how he can do it because last night, after the game, my heart was racing. And he's just on the sideline chilling.
So let's a little fun with you. I mean, we just did some impersonations, but you know, is there a college that if you could go to any college out there, what college would it be?
Any college? Whew. One, I would like to go to Baylor because you know I got family down there in Texas, and I just love the scenery. I love the program, all the education, and I want to be in sports management. So that's good out there. And I want to go to K-State, which is kind of ironic because I grew up as a KU fan. But
you came to your senses. Ain't nothing wrong with that.
Nah, K-State, they got a lot of stuff to offer. And then, I've been talking to Dale Miller, talking about, you know, maybe I can get up there, maybe not, seeing how the season go. And I've just been looking into them, and they really do have a good program up there.
So if it was football, what side of the ball would you want to play on?
Defense, DV.
Okay.
But I was on the sideline for a game you guys did against Lansing. You're a talker.
Yeah.
Are you just a mile a minute? You talking the whole game to your opponent, or?
I'm a competitor, and then you know Lansing. They had Khalil Bailey. That's all you heard, Khalil Bailey. It's like, coach, man, I don't care if he go off on me. I just want my chance to hold Khalil Bailey. Like, that's how it was. And then if I couldn't get in his head talking, you know. I just have to do something. I have to play by actions. You know, I think I did get to him a little bit. And breaking up his passes, then just talking to him. He did catch a pass and back put on me and it got in my head, but I'm competitive.
So if you could go out one night with one female, who would it be?
You would have to put me on that spot, huh?
Yeah, I mean, that's what we do here at Shoot KC. These are the fun questions.
One female that's famous is Lauren London. One female that's not, it'll probably still be my mom.
Your mom?
My mom. My mom is my best friend.
This is the second time now we got a mommy answer.
For real, I'm a mama's boy. I grew up as a mama's boy.
You got mom tattoo on? You got some ink?
Nah. I got tattoos, but I ain't got no mom tattoo.
Who is that? What is she from, Lauren London?
Lauren London, she ATL.
I ain't never heard of that. What is that?
What's ATL?
Atlanta,
the movie?
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, David.
Moving on.
Yeah. What about vehicles? You could have one car. What's your dream car?
I want these newer Camaros out here that's on the street, man. It's 2014 Camaros. The stick shift is just, I like the feel of it. I don't know why. I like this sports stuff.
You know how to drive a stick?
Yes, I do. I know how to drive.
He'll be burning it up all over. Yeah. Clutch will be beat down. Hey, let's get to our pick segment real quick. We're going to run through. We're going to ask you to make the picks. We have our guests pick the games. We won't put you on the spot. We know you're going to pick Washington against Wyandotte, so we'll just go with you there. And I do believe, Vernon, you are in the lead.
There's no belief. It's a fact, Jack.
Hey, it ain't like Bonner Springs saying,
it's a
I believe.
Fact, Jack.
Doing the I Believe chant, up 50
Dang.
In the fourth quarter. All right, let's go. First game is Turner traveling to Baser Linwood.
The 3-0 Bears.
Turner Bears riding high.
At Baser?
At Baser.
Since I'm leading and I'm winning right now, I guess I'll go ahead and pick first. Let's go Baser. I think Baser bounces back.
I feel like Turner's riding high right now. I like the energy, so I'm going to pick Turner with them.
Yeah, you should just pick them because they beat you. That's all.
Is that why? No, I agree. I think Turner's going to play a little bit better defense than what Baser can, so I'm going with Turner as well.
All right. We'll chalk that up for one for me.
Next up.
Piper.
Okay. Piper plays Bishop Ward, Caleb.
Piper.
You've never played Bishop
Ward. Piper's defense. Back-to-back shutouts.
And I've seen Piper play.
Is that right?
I take Piper.
It's going to be three.
Consecutive shutouts?
Three consecutive shutouts.
Hmm. No, I think they'll score. Time Warner Cable. I keep wanting to call it Metro Sports. Cole Henley with the long run the other day that got caught back. So, but they ain't going to run nothing up the middle against BB.
But I think this next game, too, is going to be Atchison traveling back to Harmon trying to get two wins on that field.
And they will.
And I agree.
I'll tell you Atchison, too.
Sure? I mean, come on.
I'll tell you Atchison, too, man. I really like Atchison. Even though before we played them, I was iffy about them. Like, I give them their respect when they do.
Wyandotte.
Stand-up guy you are.
You guys are at home, right?
Yes. No. We're away. Even though we was away last year, we're still away this year.
So on the new field.
Mm-hmm.
And so you put wrong location. You messed it up with my picks by putting wrong home teams.
Hey, it should rotate, so I'm not sure what happened.
Does it always rotate?
Who you got? Or am I, is it my turn?
It's your turn.
I'm taking Washington. Do it and put some kind of caveat on this because you know how Caleb likes those little caveats.
Yeah, no. Why not disappointing me? I mean, I know they didn't play with their guys, but even before that, I'm going to go Washington.
Go Wildcats.
Well, it's unanimous there. All right, we got to find against Sumner Academy faces off against Sligo. Maybe a game we go to this week. I will take – wow. I got to think about this now.
I seen Sumner on film, and they was very physical against Atchison, but I like what I'm hearing with Sligo, too. Sligo, they put no points, even though they had one game that they got blew out. They doing the thing.
Oh, they didn't get blew out. they got Molly whopped.
They beat that East team, and then they beat – basically, Wyandotte's freshman team.
Yeah.
JV team.
That's why it's hard for me to pick them, so I don't know if I'm sold on them enough.
I'm taking Sumner. What about you, Caleb?
I'd rather go with Sumner. I like the way their defense play. So we do it like that.
Whenever it's a pick 'em, I have to go with the home squad. I got to go with my alma mater, the Schlegel Stallions, Mark Snyder.
Tonganoxie hosts DeSoto.
DeSoto.
Uh-oh. You got the okey-doke put on you on that one. Just because they beat Harmon, they had lost like 20 straight games. Tongi gets that first win.
You know, that's across the border for me.
Yeah, you're actually excited about a Tonganoxie team that's not doing much right now.
Well, DeSoto can't be that good. Oh, we got another sneeze. We learned last week how he sounds when he sneezes. You're going to have to check that out when the show comes out. Who you got, Caleb?
I'm going with Toggy.
Yeah, you follow me. You good.
Yeah.
All right, Bonner Springs travels to Lansing. I'll go first, Bonner.
Stay with the Bonner momentum. Even though Lance's offense finally showed up, but Bonner.
I don't think Lansing got all their keys like they did last year, so I'm going to go with Bonner, too.
And Mill Valley.
Mill Valley by 60.
They might put up 70 on them. They lost 70-0, then 53-0. So they play Mill Valley plays Southwest Early College. You played Mill Valley a couple of times, so you know what they're about.
Yeah, they good. I seen them on TV, too, when they was playing. I forget who they played, but.
Blue Valley Northwest.
Yeah, they was doing really good on that, too.
0-3, but they're a very good 0-3 team. All right, Caleb, we appreciate you coming on the show, man.
All right, thank you.
We wish you luck the rest of the way.
All right, thank you.
This is David Brocks with Mr. Vernon Birmingham and Caleb Harrison.